Hello friends, today's topic of discussion is an epic, Gilgamesh. It is an epic poem from ancient Mesopotamia. It is regarded as the earliest surviving great work of literature and the second oldest religious text after the pyramid texts. Before starting the story, I must share some information regarding this poem so that listeners can easily understand the story, easily can memorize the story. The full title of the epic is The Epic of Gilgamesh. The ancient authors of the stories that compose the poem are unknown. They are anonymous. It is a heroic poem. It is a heroic quest. It is written in Sumerian, Akkadian, Hurrian, Hittite languages. It was written in between 2700 BC and around 600 BC in Mesopotamia, present-day Iraq. Tablet number 11 of Gilgamesh was first translated into English and published in 1872, the first comprehensive scholarly translation to be published in English was R. Campbell Thompson's in 1930. In English, the first publisher was the Clarendon Press, Oxford. Now, who is the narrator? Most of the epic is narrated by an objective, unnamed narrator. The poem has third-person narrative technique. After Enkidu appears in Tablet 1, most of the story is told from Gilgamesh's point of view. Etnapistam narrates the flood story in Tablet 11. The narrator never explicitly criticizes Gilgamesh, who is always described in the most of heroic terms, but his portrayal of him often includes irony. In the first half of the story, Gilgamesh is heedless of death to the point of rashness, while in the second, he is obsessed by it to the point of paralysis. Gilgamesh's anticlimactic meeting with Etnapistam, for example, is quietly ironic in that everyone involved, including Etnapistam and his wife, knows more than Gilgamesh does. The poem is written mainly in past tense. The setting is 2700 BC in Mesopotamia. The main protagonist is Gilgamesh, king of Uruk. The main conflict is Gilgamesh's struggle to avoid death. In the climax of the story, Enkidu dies. Now, what are the themes of the epic? The themes are love as a motivating force, the inevitability of death, the gods are dangerous. Now, I must say, what are the motives? The motives are seductions, doubling and twinship, journeys, baptism, etc. The story of this epic is about the king of Uruk, Uruk, and it is dating from the third dynasty of Ur, Ur. It was in the power in 2100 BCE. There were many stories going on in oral tradition, and these independent stories were later used as source material for a combined epic in Akkadian. The first surviving version of this combined epic, known as the old Babylonian version dates to the 18th century BCE and is titled after its incipit. In and after 13th to the 10th centuries BCE, the standard Babylonian version was compiled. It was written in Sumerian language, and the source of this epic was found in the clay tablet. On the clay tablet, the stories were written in that time. The first half of the story discusses Gilgamesh, king of Uruk, and Enkidu, a wild man created by the gods to stop Gilgamesh from oppressing the people of Uruk. After Enkidu becomes civilized through sexual intuition with a prostitute, he travels to Uruk, where he challenges Gilgamesh to a test of strength. Gilgamesh wins the contest. Nonetheless, the two become friends. They together make a six-day journey to legendary Cedar Forest, where they play to slay the Gordian, Humbaba the Terrible, and cut down the sacred cedar. The goddess Ishtar sends the bull of heaven to punish Gilgamesh for spurning her advances. Gilgamesh and Enkidu kill the bull of heaven, after which the gods decide to sentence Enkidu to death and kill him. In the second half of the poem, we find that distress over Enkidu's death causes Gilgamesh to undertake a long and perilous journey to discover the secret of eternal life. He eventually learns that life which you look for, you will never find. For when the gods created man, they let death be his share, and life withheld in their own hands. Nevertheless, because of his great building projects, his account of Siduri's advices, and what the immortal man Atnapistem told him about the great flood, Gilgamesh's fame survived well after his death, with expanding interest in the Gilgamesh story, which has become translated into many languages afterwards and is featured in works of popular fiction. The standard Babylonian version of Gilgamesh consists of 12 tablets. In the tablet number 1, the story is like this. Gilgamesh, king of Uruk, he is 2/3 of God and 1/3 man. He is oppressing his people. The people are crying out for help from gods. The gods responded to the people's plea by creating an equal to Gilgamesh, who will be able to stop his oppression. This is the primitive man, Enkidu, who is covered in hair and lives in the wild with animals. He is spotted by a tarpor, whose livelihood is being ruined because Enkidu is uprooting his trap. The tarpor tells the sun god Shamas about the man, and it is arranged for Enkidu to be seduced by Shamat, a temple prostitute. His first step towards being tamed. After 6 days and 7 nights of lovemaking and teaching Enkidu about the ways of civilization, she takes Enkidu to a shepherd's camp to learn how to be civilized. Gilgamesh, meanwhile, has been having dreams about the imminent arrival of a beloved new companion and asks his mother, Ninsan, to help interpret those dreams. Now I'm moving forward for tablet 2. Shamhat brings Enkidu to the shepherd's camp, where he introduced to a human diet and becomes the night watchman. Learning after a passing stranger about Gilgamesh's treatment of new brides, Enkidu is incensed and travels to Uruk to intervene at a wedding. When Gilgamesh attempts to visit the wedding chamber, Enkidu blocks his way and they fight. After a fierce battle, Enkidu acknowledges Gilgamesh's superior strength and they become friends. Gilgamesh proposes a journey to the Cedar Forest to slay the monstrous demigod Humbab in order to gain fame and renown. Despite warnings from Enkidu and the Council of Elders, Gilgamesh is not deterred. Now, moving forward to Tablet 3. The elders give Gilgamesh advice for his journey. Gilgamesh visits his mother, the goddess Ninsan, who seeks the support and protection of the sun god Shamshar. For this adventure, Ninsan adopts Enkidu as her son, and Gilgamesh leaves instructions for the governance of Uruk in his absence. Now moving forward to tablet number 4. Gilgamesh and Enkidu journey to Cedar Forest. Every few days, they camp on a mountain and perform a dream ritual. Gilgamesh has 5 terrifying dreams about falling mountains, thunderstorms, wild bulls, and a thunderbird that breathes fire. Despite similarities between his dream figures and earlier descriptions of Humbab, Enkidu interprets these dreams as good omens and denies that the frightening images represent the forest guardians. As they approach the Cedar Mountain, they hear Humbab bellowing and have to encourage each other not to be afraid. Now, we should move forward to the tablet number 5. The heroes entered the Cedar Forest. Humbab, the guardian of the Cedar Forest, insults and threatens them. He accuses Enkidu of betrayal and vows to disembowel Gilgamesh and feed his flesh to the birds. Gilgamesh is afraid, but with some encouraging words from Enkidu, the battle starts. The mountains quake with the tumult and the sky turns black. The god Shamshar sends 13 winds to bind Humbab and he is captured. Humbab pleads for his life and Gilgamesh pities him. He offers to make Gilgamesh king of the forest, to cut the trees for him and to be his slave. Enkidu, however, argues that Gilgamesh should kill Humbab to establish his reputation forever. Humbab curses them both and Gilgamesh dispatches him with a blow of the neck, as well as killing his 7 sons. The 2 heroes cut down many cedars, including a gigantic tree that Enkaidu plans to fashion into a gate for the temple of Enlil. They built a craft and return home along the Euphrates with the giant tree and the head of Hammurabi. Now, the story from the tablet number 6. Gilgamesh rejects the advances of the goddess Ishtar because of her mistreatment of previous lovers like Dumuzi. Ishtar asks her father Anu to send the bull of heaven to revenge her. When Anu rejects her complaints, Ishtar threatens to raise the dead who will outnumber the living and devour them. Anu states that if he gives her the bull of heaven, Uruk will face 7 years of famine. Ishtar provides him with provisions for 7 years in exchange for the bull. Ishtar leads the bull of heaven to Uruk, and it causes widespread devastation. It lowers the level of the Euphrates River and dries up the marshes, opens up huge pits that swallow 300 men. Without any divine assistance, Enkaidu and Gilgamesh attack and slay it and offer off its heart to Shamsa. When Ishtar cries out, Enkaidu hurls one of the headquarters of the bull at her. The city of Uruk celebrates, but Enkaidu has an ominous dream about his future failure. Now, the story from tablet number 7. In the dream of Enkaidu, the gods decide that one of the heroes must die because they kill Hammurabi, and despite the protestations of Shamsa, Enkaidu is marked for death. Enkaidu curses the great door he has fashioned for Enlil's temple. He also curses the Tarpo and Shamhat for reviving him from the wild. Shamash reminds Enkaidu of how Shamhat paid and clothed him and introduced him to Gilgamesh. Shamsa tells him that Gilgamesh will bestow great honor upon him at his funeral and will wander into the wild consumed with grief. Enkaidu regrets his curses and blesses Shamhat instead. In a second dream, however, he sees himself being taken captive to the netherworld by a terrifying angel of death. The underworld is a huge house of dust and darkness whose inhabitants eat clay and are clothed in bird feathers, supervised by terrifying beings. For 12 days, Enkaidu's condition worsens. Finally, after a lament that he could not meet a heroic death in battle, he dies. In a famous line from the epic, Gilgamesh clings to Enkaidu's body and denies that he has died until a maggot drops from the corpse's nose. Now, tablet number 8. Gilgamesh delivers a lament of Enkaidu, in which he calls upon mountains, forests, fields, rivers, wild animals, and all of Uruk to mourn for his friend. Recalling their adventures together, Gilgamesh tears at his hair and clothes in grief. He commissions a funerary statue and provides grave gifts from his treasury to ensure that Enkidu has a favorable reception in the realm of death. A great banquet is held where the treasures are offered to the gods of the netherworld. Just before a break in the next, there is a suggestion that a river is being dammed, indicating a burial in a river bed, as in the corresponding Sumerian poem, The Death of Gilgamesh. Now, the story from tablet number 9. It opens with Gilgamesh roaming the wild, wearing animals' skins, grieving for Enkidu. Having now become fearful of his own death, he decides to seek Atnapistem, the meaning is far away, and he learns the secret of eternal lives. Among the few survivors of the great flood, Atnapistem and his wife are the only humans to have been granted immortality by the god. Gilgamesh crosses a mountain pass at night and encounters a pride of lions. Before sleeping, he prays for protection to the moon god Sin. Then, waking from an encouraging dream, he kills the lions and uses their skins for clothing. After a long and perilous journey, Gilgamesh arrives at the twin peaks of Mountain Mashu, at the end of the earth. He comes across a tunnel, which no man has ever entered, guarded by two scorpion monsters who appear to be a married couple. The husband tries to dissuade Gilgamesh from passing, but the wife intervenes, expresses sympathy for Gilgamesh, and allows his passage. He passes under the mountains along the road of the sun. In complete darkness, he follows the road for 12 devil hours, managing to complete the trip before the sun catches up with him. He arrives at the Garden of Gods, a paradise full of jewel-laden trees. Now, the story from tablet number 10. Gilgamesh meets elf wife Sidori, who assumes that he is murderer or thief because of his disheveled appearance. Gilgamesh tells her about the purpose of his journey. She attempts to dissuade him from his quest, but sends him to Arshanabai, the ferryman, who will help him cross the sea to Atnapistem. Gilgamesh, out of spontaneous rage, destroys the stone charms that Arshanabai keeps with him. He tells him his story, but when he asks for his help, Arshanabai informs him that he has just destroyed the objects that can help them cross the waters of death, which are deadly to us. Arshanabai instructs Gilgamesh to cut down 120 trees and fashion them into punting poles. When they reach the island where Atnapistem lives, Gilgamesh recounts his story, asking him for help. Atnapistem reprimands him, declaring that fighting the common fate of humans is futile, and dismisses life's objects. Now, a story from the tablet number 11. Gilgamesh sees that Atnapistem sees no different from himself and asks him how he obtained his immortality. Atnapistem explains that the gods decided to send a great flood to save Atnapistem. The god Enki told him to build a boat. he gave him precise dimensions, and it was sealed with pitch and bitumen. In this way and that, Atnapistam describes of his having of immortality. And after that, Atnapistam challenges Gilgamesh to stay awake for 6 days and 7 nights. Gilgamesh falls asleep, and Atnapistam instructs his wife to bake a loaf of bread on each of the days he is asleep, so that he cannot deny his failure to keep awake. Gilgamesh, who is seeking to overcome death, cannot even conquer sleep. After instructing Arshanbi, the ferryman, to wash Gilgamesh and clothe him in royal robes, they depart for Uruk. As they are leaving, Atnapistam's wife asks her husband to offer a parting gift. Atnapistam tells Gilgamesh that at the bottom of the sea there lives a bostron-like plant that will make him young again. Gilgamesh, by binding stones to his feet so he can walk on the bottom, manages to obtain the plant. Gilgamesh reposes to investigate if the plant has the hypothesized rejuvenation ability by testing it on an old man once he returns to Uruk. When Gilgamesh stops to bathe, it is stolen by a serpent who sheds its skin as it departs. Gilgamesh weeps at the futility of his efforts because he has now lost all sense of immortality. He returns to Uruk, where his sight of its massive walls prompts him to praise this enduring work to Arshanbi. Now, the story from the tablet 12. This is the last tablet. It is mainly an Akkadian translation of an earlier Sumerian poem, Gilgamesh and the Netherworld. The poem is also known as Gilgamesh, Enkidu, and the Netherworld, though it has been suggested that it is derived from an unknown version of that story. The contents of its last tablet are inconsistent with previous ones. Enkidu is still alive here, despite having died earlier in the epic in another tablet. Because of this, its lack of integration with the other tablets and the fact that it is almost a copy of an earlier version, it has been referred to as an inorganic appendix to this epic. Another way, it has been suggested that its purpose, though crudely handled, is to explain to Gilgamesh the various fates of the dead in the afterlife, and in an awkward attempt to bring closure. It both connects the Gilgamesh of the epic with the Gilgamesh who is the king of the Netherworld, and is a dramatic capstone whereby the 12 tablets epic ends on one and the same theme. The themes are seeing, understanding, discovery, etc., with which the story begins. Now I am going to end the story. Gilgamesh complains to Enkidu that various of his possessions have fallen into the underworld. Enkidu offers to bring them back. Delighted, Gilgamesh tells Enkidu what he must and must not do in the underworld if he is to return again. Enkidu does everything which he was told not to do. The underworld keeps him. Gilgamesh prays to the gods to give him back his friend. Enlil and Suyen don't reply, but Enki and Shamsa decide to help. Shamsa makes a crack in the earth and Enkidu's ghost jumps out of it. The tablet ends with Gilgamesh questioning Enkidu about what he has seen in the underworld. And with this discussion of the underworld, the story ends.